Yeah, but yes, the big case everybody's talking about in the LawTube universe is of
Johnny
course
Depp. And Robert, they're calling. Okay, so people, I know if you don't like it, we've done enough important stuff. 2 hours, we can take it back a notch now and say they're calling Johnny. Amber Heard is calling Johnny Depp as a defense witness tomorrow.
Purportedly.
I'm going to be streaming in as much as I can. I think we have to stop early, but I'll stream for a bit tomorrow. Robert, what's your take on this?
So in previewing closing arguments, this is a case where the legal narrative and the moral narrative are going to show up. And how the jury was picked will tell you what happened. My view is that the moral narrative almost always trumps, and that the legal narrative almost never matters unless you can align it with at least a persuasive moral narrative. And so in this case, the key statement in the article, that's the there's a bunch of statements they're trying to go after, but the headline, number one, she didn't write the headline. Number two, the headline clearly refers to something else because in the first paragraph of the article, she's talking about something that doesn't relate to Johnny Depp. The real statement it comes down to is, and I think she, Amber Heard, may have a legal malpractice claim against the lawyer that said this phraseology was enough to keep her from being sued. Because my understanding is that probably happened. And that is that she said that 2 years ago, and basically in 2016, I came to publicly represent domestic abuse. Now, the question is that statement defamation? Under my understanding of Virginia law, the final jury will be a size of 7, I believe. They have to unanimously agree for the plaintiff, or there's no ruling in favor of the plaintiff. There's a mistrial effectively. And they have to agree on 5 factors: that Amber Heard made a statement, that Amber Heard, that statement was about Johnny Depp, that the statement was false, that the statement was defamatory, and that by clear and convincing evidence. I haven't seen the actual jury instructions they're using, but the traditional ones is that by clear and convincing evidence, she knew the statement was false or with reckless disregard, which mm-hmm. is basically in this context the same as she knew. And if you look at just that statement, 2 years ago, I came to publicly represent domestic abuse. Is that a statement that's clearly false? Well, is that a statement that she knew was false from just a legal perspective? Mm-hmm. Because that statement doesn't say 2 years ago, Johnny Depp abused me.
I became the public figure or whatever because of Johnny Depp. It's 2 years right, ago. It might've been from her child.
What her lawyer, whoever advised her, should have had her say was 2 years ago, I became the poster girl for people, for what happens when you accuse someone of domestic abuse. That would have been very hard for Johnny Depp to claim was a defamatory statement mm-hmm. about him. And I think that's what the article is trying to do, because most of the article is about the backlash she got from making an accusation. It's not about the underlying accusation. Now, her lawyers, so that's the legal narrative is tough for Johnny Depp, because it's not clear whether that statement is necessarily means he committed abuse, and most importantly, that she thought that statement was accusing him of abuse, because you have to have both and believe she thought it was false. The other aspect of that is the complaint tries to interchange the words domestic abuse with domestic violence. The mm-hmm. two are not the same. Domestic abuse by the UN, by other organizations, defines it as any kind of coercive, controlling behavior. That can be emotional abuse. That can be financial abuse. That can be physical abuse. It can be threats of violence, not actual violence. It can be threats of to property damage. It can be threats to reputation. Anything meant to control someone with a pattern of conduct. So that's very different. People have focused on whether or not Johnny Depp committed physical violence against her. There, I don't think if that's what they were voting on, she loses and Johnny Depp wins in most juries. But legally, it's not. Now, the moral narrative, I think, is what really matters. The moral narrative is that's what they're going to be asking. Was she the abuser or was he the abuser or was neither the abuser? And if he was not an abuser, she lied. I think that's the moral narrative. And the moral narrative, jury is going to definitely find for Johnny Depp. If they're following a strict legal narrative, it's 50-50.
Well, and the thing I'd been saying from the beginning, although I still did say Johnny Depp should not have filed this suit because I thought they had more dirt on Johnny than they brought up in 2 freaking weeks of trial. 2 weeks, Robert. The best they had on Johnny Depp was allegedly
Ellen Barkin.
Oh,
who's
Ellen
still
Barkin.
That he dumped her in such a summary fashion. The way she put it, the way she said, you know, well, don't even call it a romantic relationship. It was sexual. What she meant is she was still ticked. She was ticked. He was like, you're out the door.
When I heard that an ex of Johnny Depp was testifying, I was like, oh my goodness, how would an ex-wife, because he's been married a couple times, testify an ex-girlfriend from 35 years ago and the worst that she had of their tumultuous, violent relationship is he threw a bottle of wine at some point in a fight, not at anybody, but at a wall, and nobody got hurt. And for good thing,
well, that's where the better evidence she had was corroborating the controlling stuff. That's where, but I think Heard's people got behind the eight ball. They should have from the very beginning saying, hey, this essay really has nothing to do with Johnny Depp. It's about the public backlash that Amber Heard received after she made the accusations. It really doesn't concern him. And to the degree it does, it's about any conduct that constitutes abuse. Because in the complaint, they try to, it's just domestic violence, domestic abuse is not necessarily interchangeable. Because they did have some evidence of controlling behavior by Depp. Not a lot. But that was a more credible claim. You could get a jury to at least believe that Amber Heard believed that he had tried to control her.
Well, true.
That you could have done.
They had evidence of, I'll call it verbal abuse. They've had evidence of, you know, some heated call.
Text. Don't text your friends, folks, about, you know, if you're in a dispute with anybody, don't text about, you know, burning their bodies or things like that.
So they had some evidence at the very least of aggressive texts, some heated, you know, some of the recordings. If her allegations of domestic violence or abuse were verbal abuse, that would have been fine.
Or just controlling behavior, just like controlling what movie she did. Control, you know, jealousy can be a form of coercive, controlling, emotional abusive behavior. Things like a smart legal team for her would have not let her go into these allegations. The behavior panel has broken down her testimony and it looks terrible. Now, I think the cross was okay. A lot of people love the cross.
Yeah.
They're confusing the quality of the evidence with the quality of the cross. The evidence is so bad against Amber Heard on these physical abuse allegations. And the, I pledged it means I didn't give it to you, but I pledged it to you. So, you know, that routine. That was very embarrassing. Because the evidence is bad for her. The cross was solid. It went through those points, but she was too anchored to the pre-written out questions. Mm-hmm. So to me, the sign of a great cross would have been to get Amber Heard to go nuts in front of the jury. If she had done it live, and this is why I encourage lawyers to do it live. And what I mean by doing it live, not, you know, Bill O'Reilly, do it live. I will do it live. Not just that. It's that you're not anchored to a pre-written out set of questions. You have just topics listed. And you might have a few specific questions to make sure you phrase certain things correctly, but mostly it's just topical. Because whenever the lacrosse examiner brought up Amber Heard getting advanced in her movie career because of Johnny Depp, she lost it. But she would only lose it briefly. And then there would be no real follow-up to get her to keep going off. It was clear that was her trigger. She even said, like, excuse me? I mean, did that whole routine. It's like you could get her to go full Karen in front of that whole jury. And she did. She blew that opportunity because she was too anchored to it. Now, she had great evidence to play with, and she didn't blow that. So it was, like I said, a solid cross. I would not use it as, like, a teaching example because it could have been a lot better than it was.
It was obvious that she was reading from a list of questions. She spoke an answer, and then she asked the next question.
I mean,
totally
good tone,
independent.
Good tenor, good physical, emotional discipline expression, good point, you know, making the point of how the evidence rebuts her. I mean, it just, you know, there's a bunch of evidence that just exposes her. So, you know, you got beat up with his rings. You know, Johnny Depp's always wears rings. Yeah. And so
she
that means
she's never known him to not wear rings. Always, always. I mean, exactly. It was good. I need to go watch. Apparently, I need to go watch Gone Girl because of apparently some of her allegations were straight out of verbatim out of The Talented Mr. Ripley, and some of the accusations straight out of Gone Girl. I'm going to go watch that tonight if there's time.
We did part of the cross live, and it was clear that she had done a mixture. She had taken stories that really happened to her, but not by Johnny Depp.
Mm-hmm.
She had taken stories other people had told her that never even happened to her. And had taken stories that had been in popular culture. And she did the Anita Hill. This is what Anita Hill did. And she mixed the three into allegations against Depp. Those allegations I found all incredulous. The behavior panel broke it down and said it's one of the worst because she's not like a sociopath. She is histrionic.
Histrionic, I think is the word.
Histrionic. Yeah. Because she leaks emotion badly. Now, I think some of her friends and sister testified were good witnesses. I get that the Depp fans don't want to hear anybody's a good witness against Depp, et cetera. I get that. Now, I think Depp has already achieved what he set out to, which was to use the trial to win over the court of public opinion to establish the legacy that he was right. Amber Heard can't pay a judgment against him that he's seeking. I mean, a tiny share of it she could ever pay. So it's not about the judgment. It was about winning in the court of public opinion for his legacy and then potentially maybe getting some movie deals back. That he has won in at an extraordinary level. So, you have Vice and the Daily Beast and some other people that are writing some pieces that even questioning Amber Heard means you're part of a misogynistic, violent,
I can't believe what's going on. There was one guy who said, I don't care. I'm just believing Amber Heard. I think this is actually what kind of led to the fight a misunderstanding with Michelle on Twitter yesterday, which we've made up for.
Michelle.
There's just some Twitter. Well, it was someone on Twitter, and I said, as a joke, you know, I believe the author, Raven_something says, I believe Amber Heard. I believe women. And I think, okay, well, great. Then
she said at the end of her article, the one in the UK. UK Vogue UK is one of those. UK that said, absolutely, we have to believe all women. Amber Heard beat up?
Forget that. Let's say here's the solution. Johnny Depp says he identifies as a woman. Checkmate. Who are you going to believe now? And it wasn't a trans joke. It's a joke of believing an individual based on identity aspects and not evidence. I was like, I believe women. Okay, well, that's great.
What about men who call themselves women?
And if you believe that or you don't, the issue is if you believe anything that is above and beyond evidence, well, you're into faith and you're not into actual, you're not into science. Call it legal science. But I can't believe the pieces coming out that basically say, you know, they're going after Rakeda. I can understand Rakeda or the chat because the chat's a mean chat. But the bottom line, you're not a misogynist for saying I don't believe this particular woman because of the quality of the evidence that has not been adduced after 2 solid weeks.
It's amazing that the Rakeda chat is they're really obsessed with the Federal Unemployment Tax Act. They're always asking about FUTA. We'll see. But they're going after all of them. Emily Baker, I think, got over 1 million views for one of her live broadcasts of the.
It's magnificent. It's magnificent.
The gatekeepers are not going to be happy about that. So the gatekeepers are not going to want LawTube to have any influence on how people perceive this. I think the social impact of this case is that Me Too can be Men Too. I mean, that was already known, but it will be, if verdict goes a certain way, it will be seen as maybe bookmarking the end of the Me Too movement's popular dominance, excluding Men Too. And then otherwise, it's just an interesting celebrity case that had some evidentiary value. You can see judges misapply the hearsay rule on every day, basically, every other minute. And you could see, I thought, average lawyering for the most case, and then I think mostly the Amber Heard side had the much worse evidence. But they could have structured this case a lot better given how vague her statements were.
They could have said, I was a victim of verbal abuse, controlling behavior. I instigated it. That's it.
You have him on tape saying some unfortunate things. You got him on some text saying some unfortunate things. You got Ellen Barkin, the one ex of all of Johnny Depp's ex, the one that didn't like being basically she was friends with benefits, but without the friends part. So, you know, they have a word for that.
Oh, I have no doubt. Both of them were drinking on drugs and they were both having fun 30 years ago. That's the best evidence they could have is that 35 years ago, he threw a bottle in an art. Good. I've never done it.
Got high. He did some dumb stuff, but no, I thought the closest thing she could get to proving was maybe he was controlling in certain ways. I didn't believe it in the end, but like that was she had at least a little bit of evidence for that. She really, and some emotionally harsh things said that you could imagine that she thought, and that's what if I was presenting her defense, it would be very simple. In other words, did she believe that Johnny Depp behaved badly towards her? Because that's what abuse really is. And that's it. And that's what you're here to decide. Do you believe there's clear and convincing evidence that Amber Heard did not believe Johnny Depp did anything bad to her? I mean, the reality, and then I would play off the prejudices that people have about people who get drunk and high and say, come on, we've all been around friends that, you know, did a little mm-hmm. bunch of this, did too much of this. You need a little Jekyll and Hyde. We heard some of the tapes. We saw some of the exes, you know, like Johnny, but, you know, he wasn't always the best in this situation. And this article really wasn't about him anyway. He just kind of imagined it was. And his real problem, reason why he lost these movie deals, too much of this, you know, and just do it that way. Like the beginning, a good closing statement is Harrison Ford's character in the movie regarding Henry, which is one of the most brutal. He manages to tell a closing argument that convinces the jury to screw a disabled old guy, right? But he does it in such a brilliant manner. It's like, all right, there, that's how you do that when you got a popular person on the other side. If I'm Depp's people, I make this just about Amber Heard. It's like, do you believe Amber Heard or not? Do you believe she's a hopeless, helpless liar and abuser or not?
I can't
wait. You believe she's a liar, you believe she's an abuser, you know what the verdict needs to be, you know what the verdict is, you know what the verdict requires. She's guilty. She lied right to your face, day after day, hour after hour, minute after minute, trying to look you down while she told the lies. Lies that were caught by the photos, lies that were caught by third-party witnesses, lies that were caught by even police who showed up at the scene at the time, lies who were caught by every independent source of corroborative evidence we have. She claimed she was beaten up in such a horrific, terrific, terrible way. The next day, she's wearing a backless dress to a big popular event and smiling from ear to ear. So, I mean, you just take it apart one by one, make that the focal.
And we're going to see the closing arguments are going to be amazing. And I'm saying this, like, you know, people talk about my nose being big and red. I bumped my nose when I was swimming in the family neighbor's pool. And I was looking for goggles and I bumped my nose on the ground, just bumping it. It's swollen, it's bruised, and it hurts. If she had sustained the abuse that she alleges she did, you're not on James Corden the next day, immaculate. So we'll see. Closing arguments are going to be amazing. I'm gonna live
Friday,
no matter what.
It's going to be Friday, no matter what. I think most of the evidence is presented. If the Heard's team calls Depp, it means they're desperate and think they're going to lose. Now, a lot of people are watching the jury, reading the jury. I'm deeply skeptical that that's okay. You can't read almost anything into that. I can guarantee you that from learned experience. Very hard. Juries know they're being watched. So you don't know why they don't appear to be paying attention if they're not. You're not making eye contact. Very hard to know. It can often be exactly the opposite of what you think. And so it's very, very tough to read a jury unless you know tons about them and you've been watching them the whole time and you can watch their lower body language, things that nobody is doing. So so I get people are trying to do what they can do. But my view is I think the moral narrative trumps. Amber Heard's team made a tactical mistake about making this about physical violence, making this about Amber Heard. And I think the moral narrative, he loses.
Grotesque physical violence. It was not.
I mean, she just kept adding to it. It's like, but liars have a tendency to do that. They tend to exaggerate more and more and more. And it's part of the histrionic personality type. In their drama-seeking behavior, they exaggerate and exaggerate and exaggerate. And a disciplined legal team on her behalf, apparently she spent $6-7 million, had multiple years to prepare for this, prepared a different defense and would have focused her in a different direction. And if they had, legally, she had some defenses because her statement is really, really vague.
Oh, no. And she spent her pledge money. So there's going to be that to deal with later on.
I pledged it.
Oh, yeah. Oh, no, I donated it. Oh, when I said
that's going to become a word now. It's like kafefe. That's going to enter the entire lexicon of the American. Oh, no, no. I know I didn't give it to you yet, but I pledged it. Don't worry.
Someone pledged me 1 million pesos, which I might take you up on later.